It's Fran in the lab, and I've got the report, the unclassified UFO report, or UAP report, just released minutes ago, so I haven't even had a chance to read it. But this is from the Office of the Director of National Intelligence. It is the unclassified version. The classified, unredacted version was given to Congress several weeks ago. So this is the one that's publishable without all of the secure military data and everything in it. But let's just get right into it. The report. A preliminary assessment of unidentified aerial phenomena, 25th of June, 2021. Scope and assumptions. This is just the overview. This preliminary report is provided by the Office of the Director of National Intelligence, the ODNI, in response to the provision in Senate Report 116233. That's the little caveat in the big bill last year that mandated this. Accompanying the Intelligence Authorization Act, yada yada. So this report provides an overview for policymakers, challenges, yada yada. The ODNI prepared this report for the Congressional Intelligence and Armed Services Committees and Air Force, Army, yada yada. Assumptions. Various forms of sensors that register UAP generally operate correctly and capture enough real data to allow initial assessments, but some UAP may be attributable to sensor anomalies. Executive summary. The limited amount of high-quality reporting on unidentified aerial phenomena, UAPs, hampers our ability to draw firm conclusions about the nature or intent of UAP. The Unidentified Aerial Phenomenon Task Force, the UAPTF, considered a range of information on UAP described in U.S. military and IC intelligence community reporting, but because the reporting lacks sufficient specificity, ultimately recognized that a unique, tailored reporting process was required to provide sufficient data for analysis of UAP events. So as a result, the UAPTF concentrated its review on reports that occurred between 2004 and 2021, the majority of which are the result of this new tailored process to better capture UAP events through formalized reporting. So they're squeezing out the hearsay and the you know, they said that this said, you know, they want to just get real actual data that they can confirm. Most of the UAP reported probably do represent physical objects, given that a majority of the UAP were registered across multiple sensors, including radar, infrared, electro-optical, weapons seekers, and visual observations. So again, they're correlating cases that represent real objects, not ball lightning or flare, you know, light flares or any kind of other kinds of phenomena that might not be an actual physical object. In a limited number of incidents, UAP reportedly appeared to exhibit unusual flight characteristics. These observations could be the result of sensor errors, spoofing, or observer misperception, and require additional rigorous analysis. So they're not going to make any conclusions about the weird maneuvering. There are probably multiple types of UAP requiring different explanations based on a range of appearances and behaviors described in the available reporting. Okay. Our analysis of the data supports the construct that if and when individual UAP incidents are resolved, that they will fall into one of five potential explanatory categories: airborne clutter, natural atmospheric phenomena, USG or US industry development programs, foreign adversary systems, and in a catch-all, other bin. UAP clearly pose a safety of flight issue and may pose a challenge to US national security. Safety concerns primarily center on aviators contending with an increasingly cluttered air domain. UAP would also represent a national security challenge if they are foreign adversary collection platforms or provide evidence a potential adversary has developed either a breakthrough or disruptive technology. This is the, you know, the reason why we want to investigate these things. If it turns out that these are really bizarre weapons systems or surveillance systems, it's just important to find out that as if they were not. Consistent consolidation of reports from across the federal government, standardized reporting, increased collection and analysis, and a streamlined process for screening all such reports against a broad range of relevant USG data will allow for a more sophisticated analysis of UAP that is likely to deepen our understanding. Some of these steps are resource intensive and would require additional investment. So they're saying right off the bat that they've only really been collecting data, like purposefully collecting data, just for the last few years, since 2019. If they have the money to focus resources on actually building equipment and platforms and sensors that are specific to tracking and better identifying UAPs, then they'll have more data. I think that's really what they're leading to. If you throw money at it, we'll get you more answers. That's what this is leading to. Okay. Available reporting largely inconclusive, is what they say. Limited data leaves most UAP unexplained. Limited data and inconsistency in reporting are key challenges to evaluating UAP. No standardized reporting mechanism existed until the Navy established one in March 2019. The Air Force subsequently adopted that mechanism in November 2020, but it remains limited to USG reporting. So this is a very, very new process. They don't really have it all together yet. The UAPTF regularly heard anecdotally during its research about other observations that occurred, but which were never captured in formal or informal reporting by those observers. So again, they're not entering into the record any of the anecdotal, I saw this. It's got to be recorded on some kind of reliable sensor platform in addition to that. Okay. After carefully considering this information, the UAPTF focused on reports that involved UAP largely witnessed firsthand by military aviators and that were collected from systems we consider to be reliable. So again, they're trying to get wheat from the chaff. Okay. These reports describe incidents that occurred between 2004 and 2021, with the majority coming in the last 2 years as the new reporting mechanism became better known to the military aviation community. We were able to identify one reported UAP with high confidence, and in that case, we identified the object as a large deflated balloon. The others remain unexplained. So again, they're saying that they can, it, you know, something as obvious as a weather balloon, they can determine that it's that. I would think that, you know, weather balloons used to be the number one thing, like when people would observe UAPs or UFOs. It would be Venus or a planet, you know, at twilight, or a star or a distant aircraft with slanting lights, or a weather balloon, you know, hovering. But, you know, when you're in a fighter jet, it's pretty easy to figure out whether what you're looking at is a balloon or not, because balloons don't have propulsion. They have to go with the air currents, and if you're in a jet fighter and you know your velocity and you know your airspeed, it's very easy to figure out the airspeed of something that you're, you know, trailing behind or moving with. Okay, so this is where it gets down to the nitty-gritty. 114 reports originated from USG sources. That's just the last couple of years that they're putting in there. Of these, 80 reports involved observation with multiple sensors. Most reports described UAP as objects that interrupted pre-planned training or other military activity. This seems to be the real cusp from a military perspective of really why the military is so interested in this, is because of the increasing realization that these encounters, jets are encountering these phenomena in areas that are either restricted airspace or airspace that is used for training or other kinds of military exercises, and they're getting more of this stuff happening in these cordoned off areas. So that's one of the concerns. So we're getting into the nitty-gritty. UAP collection challenges. Socio-cultural stigmas and sensor limitations remain obstacles for collecting data on UAP. Although some technical challenges, such as how to appropriately filter out radar clutter to ensure safety of flight for military and civilian aircraft, are long-standing in the aviation community, while others are unique to the UAP problem set. Narratives from aviators in the operational community and analysis from the military and IC describe disparagement associated with observing UAP, reporting it, or attempting to discuss it with colleagues. So this is one of the this is the long-standing reason why pilots never talked about this stuff. Although the effect of these stigmas have lessened as senior members of the scientific, policy, military, and intelligence communities engage on the topic seriously in public, reputational risk may keep many observers silent, complicating scientific pursuit of the topic. This has always been the problem with this phenomena, is the stigma. That's the thing. Every pilot in the air has a story, and they don't talk about it because of the stigma. Okay. The sensors mounted on U.S. military platforms are typically designed to fulfill specific missions. As a result, those sensors are not generally suited for identifying UAP. Sensor vantage points and the numbers of sensors concurrently observing an object play substantial roles in distinguishing UAP from known objects and determining whether a UAP demonstrates breakthrough aerospace capabilities. Optical sensors have the benefit of providing some insight into relative size, shape, and structure. Radio frequency sensors provide more accurate velocity and range information. This goes to one of the things that people commented a lot in my first video about some of the debunking videos is, oh, if you look at the data on the, you know, on the heads-up display, it's telling you all these things, and these things mean something. Well, yes, but people who actually use those systems, they correlated that data with ground-based systems, with ship-based radar, with other aircraft. This is not just one thing. You know, they're weeding out all those things that could be dubious or not have really good information. They're really going for events that are established in multiple sensor platforms. So I think this is very interesting. This is declassified, of course. There's no security-sensitive information, but I don't think this is as poo-pah as people in the press are, you know, calling it out to be. I think they're being very cautious, which I think is good, but they're also opening the door to saying this is a real thing, and we've only just started looking at it, you know, seriously. And already we have mysteries that can't be solved. That I think is the takeaway from this report on page 5. but some potential patterns do emerge. Okay, although there is a wide variability in the reports, and the data set is currently too limited to allow for detailed trend or pattern analysis, there were some clustering of UAP observations regarding shape, size, and particularly propulsion. UAP sightings also tended to cluster around U.S. training and testing grounds, where we assess that this may result from a collection of bias as a result of focused attention, greater numbers of latest generation sensors operating in those areas, unit expectations, and guidance to report anomalies. That's very interesting. And a handful of UAP appeared to be domestic advanced technology. In 18 incidents described in 21 reports, observers reported unusual UAP movement patterns or flight characteristics. Some UAP appeared to remain stationary in winds aloft, move against the wind, maneuver abruptly, or move at considerable speed without discernible means of propulsion. In the small number of cases, military aircraft systems processed radio frequency, RF energy, associated with UAP sightings. The UAPTF holds a small amount of data that appear to show UAP demonstrating acceleration or a degree of signature management. Additional rigorous analysis are necessary by multiple teams or groups of technical experts to determine the nature and validity of these data. We are conducting further analysis to determine if breakthrough technologies were demonstrated. I find that very interesting. I think that's pretty heavy. That's pretty heavy. Wow. UAP probably lack a single explanation. The UAP documented in this limited data set demonstrate an array of aerial behaviors, reinforcing the possibility that there are multiple types of UAP requiring different explanations. Our analysis of the data supports the construct that if and when individual UAP incidents are resolved, they will fall into one of five potential explanatory categories. That's what they said before: airborne clutter, natural atmospheric phenomenon, industry development programs, foreign adversary systems, or the other catch-all. We already read that. Okay. But the exception of the one instance where we determined with high confidence that the reported UAP was an airborne clutter, a weather balloon, specifically a deflated balloon, we currently lack sufficient information in our data set to attribute incidents to specific explanations. So, airborne clutter. These objects include birds, balloons, recreational unmanned aerial vehicles or drones, airborne debris like plastic bags that muddle a scene and affect the operator's ability to identify true targets such as enemy aircraft. So believe it or not, as this is one of the, I think, number one on the people who want to point to the debunking videos, number on the list, the U.S. Navy knows the difference between a bird and something else. Number one. You know, trillions of dollars and millions of person hours of training and research, the military know how to distinguish the difference between birds and aircraft. So, number two, natural atmospheric phenomena. Natural atmospheric phenomena includes ice crystals, moisture, and thermal fluctuations that may register on some infrared and radar systems. So, guess what? They know the difference between strange and kind of rare phenomena and actual solid objects. Who thunk it? USG or industry development programs. Some UAP observations could be attributed to developments in classified programs by US entities. We were unable to confirm, however, that these systems accounted for any of the UAP reports we collected. That was something that the Navy aviators had said in that extended interview. That 60 Minutes thing was kind of condensed, but there's another podcast, one of those pilots had like a four-hour podcast where they went into crazy detail. And one of the things that they talked about in that interview was this idea that the possibility of weapon systems, experimental weapon systems, but they did say that, well, that there's no way that American weapons systems developers would be secretly testing new technology in known training areas and cordoned off military airspace without the knowledge of the U.S. Navy and NORAD. That they just don't do that. It's not like we've got loose cannons with trillions of dollars developing propulsion systems that they're not even telling their bosses about. That's just not how it operates. But as far as like perhaps foreign technology, you know, if there's a Chinese-made submarine-launched drones, we should know about that too, just like anything else. But yeah. So the foreign adversary systems, some UAPs, maybe technologies developed by China, Russia, another nation, or a non-governmental entity. That's interesting, a non-governmental entity. So they're taking into consideration that there might be private individuals doing stuff. And just, that's kind of interesting. There's Musk and Bezos and that other guy, the Virgin Galactic guy. And maybe there's some other billionaire with their own secret propulsion program, and they're not telling anybody about it. All possible. Okay, and the other category. Although most of the UAP described in our data set probably remain unidentified due to limited data or challenges to collection, processing, or analysis, we may require additional scientific knowledge to successfully collect on, analyze, and characterize some of them. We would group such objects in this category pending scientific advances that allow us to better understand them. The UAPTF intends to focus additional analysis on the small number of cases where UAP appeared to display unusual flight characteristics or signature management. The UAPTF has 11 reports of documented instances in which pilots reported near misses with a UAP. Potential national security change. Okay. We continue to monitor for evidence of such programs that give counterintelligence a challenge that they would pose, particularly that some UAP have been detected near military facilities, so it's leaving that open. Explaining UAP will require analytic collection and resource investment. standardize the reporting, consolidate the data, and deepen the analysis. In line with provisions of Senate Report 116-233, okay, they're just going back to the beginning, the initial focus will be to employ artificial intelligence, machine learning systems as a database, okay, so they're just talking about what they're going to do in the future. We're going to develop interagency, analytical, blah, 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 blah. Okay. We're on the last page here. The majority of the UAP data is from U.S. Navy reporting, but efforts are underway to standardize incident reports across U.S. military services and other government agencies to ensure all relevant data is captured with respect to particular incidents and any U.S. activities that might be relevant. The UAPTF is currently working to acquire additional reporting, including from the U.S. Air Force, and has begun receiving data from the Federal Aviation Administration. Though the U.S. Air Force data collection has been limited historically, the U.S. Air Force began a six-month pilot program in November 2020 to collect in the most likely areas to encounter UAP, and is evaluating how to normalize future collection, reporting, and analysis across the entire Air Force. The FAA captures data related to UAP during the normal course of managing air traffic operations. The Federal Aviation Administration generally ingests this data when pilots and other airspace users report unusual or unexpected events to the FAA's air traffic organization, just like in Close Encounters. Do you want to report a UFO over? Nah, I don't want to report one of those things.
EWA 517, do you want to report a UFO over?
Negative. We don't want to report.
Ares 31, do you wish to report a UFO over?
Negative. We don't want to report one of those either.
In addition, the FAA continuously monitors its systems for anomalies, generating additional information that may be of use to the UAPTF. Okay, so the FAA is able to isolate data of interest to the UAPTF and make it available. So, again, this is very important. This is the first time in history that they're actually combining FAA radar data, U.S. Air Force data, and U.S. Navy data in a succinct way, and they said they're going to use machine learning, artificial intelligence to process huge amounts of data to try and, you know, get a better idea of what we're looking at. So I think this is a big deal. Expand collection. The UAPTF is looking for novel ways to increase collection of UAP cluster areas when U.S. forces are not present as a way to baseline standard UAP activity and mitigate the collection bias on the data set. One proposal is to use advanced algorithms to search historical data captured and stored by radars. The UAPTF also plans to update its current interagency UAP collection strategy in order to bring to bear relevant collection platforms and methods from the DoD and the IC. Increase investment in research and development. Increase investment in research and development. We want the bucks. The UAPTF has indicated that additional funding for research and development could further the future study of the topics laid out in this report. Such investments should be guided by UAP collection strategy, UAP R&D technical roadmap, and the UAP program plan. And that's the appendix. Another appendix, okay. Just saying that the sources of data, but that's pretty much it in a long nutshell. The unclassified report. My take on it is it's interesting on many levels. One is it is what people expected it to be. There's no shocking revelation. But of course, the interesting thing too is the fact that there's no shocking revelation is one of the reasons why the military hasn't been talking about this. But the fact that they are coordinating multiple agencies to collect data, the fact that they're working on new systems specific to UAPs, and the idea of going into radar records to try to find where UAPs are clustered in order to have a better chance of observing them when they're there, and the idea of having normal patterns, establishing normal patterns of UAPs is very interesting. I'm not discouraged. I think this is the beginning of something that could be very enlightening. So You know, I say give them some dollars, let them gather data, and you know, if they have equipment that they install, for instance, let's say they get the money to install special equipment on Navy aircraft specifically to get better information on UAPs alone, then you know, might end up getting some of the things that people are asking for. You know, people are saying, why don't we have like really good pictures? Why don't we have like really good video? Well, as it says in the report, systems that capture these objects are systems that are designed to capture very specific things, and they're not intended to make really crisp pictures in missile guidance systems or to have really great video. That's not what they're designed to do. But what they're saying is we need to design systems that do just that and put them in the hardware that are already encountering UAPs. And then in a few years, we might actually have those kinds of things that people are really wanting, you know, like real 4K video, you know. But it requires specific equipment, as they say in the report. They need specific equipment to be able to capture better data specifically for UAPs. But to be continued, but very interesting in my view. I'm not disappointed. I think it's very interesting. So that's it. That's it for this one. Great revelations. So I'm Fran. I'll be back here in the lab with something else real soon. Thanks. And thanks to all the patrons down there for supporting all this crazy stuff I do and hanging in there with me, supporting my crazy, crazy stuff I do. So thank you, thank you, thank you, everybody on Patreon. Bye! That's where I work. Berserk in my lab, it's where I work. At the bench.